a woman attends her ex-boyfriend's wedding and shockingly discovers that he cheated on her with his current bride. In retaliation, she boldly rips off a tablecloth to use as a dress, takes a guest's scarf for a veil, and grabs a bouquet from a table. She brazenly poses for a photo next to the groom. From a young age, Son Hae-young was never one to back down. In elementary school, she was upset that the teacher allocated 80% of the playground to boys playing soccer, leaving a small area for the girls. She confronted the teacher, which led to her being isolated by her peers. Her mother, known for her kindness and justice, often took in temporarily homeless children. Son Hae-young would compete with them for food, feeling that she was the one at a disadvantage as these children shared her food and mother's love. As an adult, Son Hae-young attended various weddings and gave a significant amount of money as gifts. For her, who has no plans to marry, these gifts felt like a loss. On this day, she attends the wedding of a colleague and ex-boyfriend. Initially, she planned to give 100,000 won, but after being reminded of their close ties, she decided to give 300,000 won. Remembering the total sum she had spent over the years could have bought a car. Gift giving is a national consensus, seemingly fair but complex, influenced by factors like inflation, travel, and accommodation costs for different weddings. Some people might never keep in touch, making it seem like the giver is at a loss. Her ex-boyfriend is surprised by Son Hae-young's attendance, which could spark rumors and potentially reveal their past office romance. Before the wedding, Son Hae-young receives a call from a nursing home about her mother, who has Alzheimer's disease. Busy with work, she had to send her mother there and hasn't visited in 2 weeks. At the wedding, the entrance of the bride and groom's parents reminds her of her breakup. Her drunk ex-boyfriend had repeatedly asked if she was solely responsible for her mother, viewing her as a burden. To avoid burdening him, she painfully initiated a breakup. When her ex-boyfriend tried to retain their relationship, he accidentally fell and scraped his hand. Son Hae-young, feeling sorry, applied a band-aid to his wound. As she recalls this, a proposal photo of her ex-boyfriend and his bride is displayed, showing the band-aid she had applied. Someone mentions that today marks the couple's 1-year anniversary. Realizing that her ex-boyfriend proposed to his bride on the same day they broke up 6 months ago, Son Hae-young concludes he was unfaithful during their relationship. Son Hae-young was furious when she heard the photographer calling friends and family to take group photos with the newlyweds. She imagined herself wearing a makeshift wedding dress, standing next to her ex-boyfriend in a distasteful scene. In reality, she did nothing but stand next to the bride and unexpectedly caught the bouquet. Upon returning home, Son Hae-young regretted the money she spent on the wedding gift. Had she known her ex-boyfriend was such a scoundrel, she would have never attended the wedding. Her friend suggested that she could recover the gift money by getting married soon herself. Two friends were curious about why Son Hae-young broke up with her scoundrel ex-boyfriend. It seemed like nothing major had happened. They just suddenly split. However, her friends believe Son Hae-young wouldn't let herself be shortchanged given her history. 6 years ago, she dumped her first boyfriend because he stayed at her place almost daily without ever bringing anything or replacing used items. 3 years ago, she broke up with another boyfriend due to his poor performance in bed, as she always had to initiate, and it was over before she enjoyed it. On the way home, Son Hae-young wanted to buy gummies at a convenience store with a friend. They talked about Kim Ji-wook, a man who worked there part-time. Son complained that Kim Ji-wook acted like a mad dog around her, despite seeming like a kind angel to others. The more Kim Ji-wook disliked her, the more she wanted to cause trouble. At the convenience store, Son Hae-young saw Kim Ji-wook cleaning the windows. She pressed her handprints on the cleaned spots and messed up the neatly arranged shelves. When she bought cigarettes, Kim Ji-wook intentionally gave her a pack with the highest tar content. Son accused Kim Ji-wook of trying to kill her, arguing that for the same price, a lower tar content would be a better deal. They exchanged insults. Son mocked him for not having a proper job, and Kim hit a sore spot by saying he would find a job once she got married. The next day at work, Son Hae-young exposed her ex-boyfriend's infidelity and demanded the 300,000 won she gave as a wedding gift. Her ex promised to repay her once she married. As he left, he mocked her shrewdness and wondered if she would ever get married. Son Hae-young was angry and wanted her ex-boyfriend to realize that only he would lose out by crossing her. To teach her ex a lesson, she arranged a meeting with his new wife under the guise of being a colleague and called him in front of her. Hearing his wife's voice, He panicked and rushed to the meeting place to explain. He realized something was amiss when Son Hae-young gave his wife a dry flower candle made from the bouquet she caught at the wedding. The call was just to intimidate him. Back at the office, her ex-boyfriend begged Son Hae-young for forgiveness on his knees. Son Hae-young just wanted her 300,000 won back. Her ex lamented that he only received 200,000 won as pocket money each month, which was charged to a financial card, and his wife managed all his accounts. Any unauthorized movement of money would cause a huge commotion. Although he was a cheater in Son Hae-young's eyes, he hoped to remain a good husband in his wife's eyes. He promised to repay the wedding gift when Son Hae-young got married and begged her to let him go. Son Hae-young remained silent and ultimately gave up. Recently, the company announced a creative contest. The employee who wins first place will not only work directly under the president, but will also receive a fast-track promotion. Son Hae-young vowed to win first place. Her colleagues cautioned her that despite her excellence, she stood no chance because the president's directly managed department does not hire unmarried female employees. This was due to the company chairman's disorderly private life in the past. To curb his infidelities, the chairman's wife had instituted this policy. It also served to prevent their son from following in his father's footsteps. Son Hae-young was heartbroken. She had not expected the chairman to be such a scoundrel, indirectly ruining her bright career prospects. To vent, Son Hae-young went to a convenience store to drink. She remembered her ex-boyfriend saying he would return the wedding gifts once she married. Her colleague mentioned that if she were married, the fast-track promotion would be hers. At that moment, her desire to marry peaked. Just then, she accidentally made eye contact with Kim Ji-wook inside the store. Son Hae-young instantly thought of a perfect solution. When Kim Ji-wook came out to ask what she wanted, Son Hae-young proposed marriage to him. Kim Ji-wook flatly refused. His grandmother had advised him to marry a kind and gentle girl, not someone beautiful like his mother, who had him out of wedlock and irresponsibly abandoned him. Thankfully, his grandmother raised him. Kim Ji-wook remembered her teachings. In his eyes, Son Hae-young was neither modest nor demure. Defiant, Son Hae-young claimed she epitomized kindness and propriety. Kim Ji-wook ruthlessly exposed her lies. 6 years ago, after breaking up with her first boyfriend, Son Hae-young had him pay for a pile of household items at a convenience store as revenge for freeloading at her place. 3 years ago, she and her second boyfriend bought a bunch of condoms there, and she warned him to perform well that night, or their relationship would end. Son Hae-young was shocked that Kim Ji-wook remembered these disgraceful acts so clearly. Her first proposal attempt having failed, she gave up. The next day at work, Kwon Yi-rin, the wife of her ex-boyfriend and an HR department employee, summoned Son Hae-young, thinking it was work-related. Just as she sat down, her ex-boyfriend entered. Kwon Yi-rin revealed that she needed to confront them both, suspecting an office romance. Son Hae-young tried to explain, but Kwon Yi-rin approached with a coffee pot aimed at her face. Son Hae-young quickly leaned back, causing the coffee to spill all over her ex-boyfriend's face. Kwon Yi-rin was actually pouring Son Hae-young a cup of coffee, snapping her back from her imagined scenario. Kwon Yi-rin explained that she had called them because she found their submissions for the creative contest to be 90% similar. She suspected they might have collaborated or shared ideas previously, leading to the overlap. She hoped to resolve this internally before the president noticed. Son Hae-young suddenly remembered sharing her ideas with her ex-boyfriend before they broke up. She had turned these ideas into her contest submission, not realizing her ex-boyfriend would shamelessly plagiarize her creativity for a similar submission. Her ex-boyfriend later cornered Son Hae-young in the stairwell, claiming she couldn't win first place because the president's directly managed department wouldn't hire an unmarried woman. Moreover, his mother-in-law, Kwon Yi-rin's mother, was a close friend of the president's mother. If he uses his connections, Son Hae-young has no chance. Son Hae-young confronts her ex-boyfriend. If he doesn't back down, she'll go to HR and expose everything. When, where, and why she shared her thoughts with him, even mentioning that they discussed this in bed. Her ex-boyfriend threatens her. If she speaks out, he'll tell everyone that the project plan was Son Hae-young's revenge for not wanting to break up. Then Son Hae-young will be seen as a woman clinging to a married ex. Son Hae-young warns her ex not to celebrate too soon, as she is getting married in a month. Back at her desk, Son Hae-young immediately prints the wedding preparation list. Planning a fake wedding, she opts for simplicity and selects three tasks: book the engagement venue, choose a wedding dress, and print invitations. After work, Son Hae-young pleads with Kim Ji-wook. She's interrupted by a student buying something. Patiently, Son Hae-young waits for Kim Ji-wook to finish before she continues. However, the students keep interrupting her. Son Hae-young turns and yells at the students, reinforcing her reputation for arrogance, which leads Kim Ji-wook to dislike her even more. Despite Kim Ji-wook's attitude, Son Hae-young isn't discouraged. At home, she starts organizing the guest list and tells two friends about her plan for a sham marriage. Marriage means she can recover the wedding gifts and even get a promotion. It's a good deal, she believes. Her friend Cha Hee-seong disapproves of treating the wedding as a transaction, especially since the guests include her mother's friends, making her mother a sacrifice for the deal. He accuses Son Hae-young of not liking her mother, only acknowledging her when needed. Cha Hee-seong and Nam Ji-yeon were foster children cared for by Son Hae-young's mother. Both know Son Hae-young resented sharing her mother's love. Growing up, she was distant from her mother. After a disagreement, Son Hae-young and Cha Hee-seong have a fight. The next day, Son Hae-young books the wedding venue and arranges for the banquet 3 weeks later. She leaves without noticing her phone was left behind. When she returns for her phone, she receives a call from the nursing home about her mother's sudden violent episode. Son Hae-young rushes to the hospital, where she and Cha Hee-seong calm her mother down. Previously, Son Hae-young had hidden her mother's illness and hospitalization from her friends. Now, to prevent emergencies, she leaves Cha Hee-seong's number with the hospital. At this meeting, Cha Hee-seong still disagrees with the fake marriage. Son Hae-young admits, as someone who hates losing and is petty, it's hard to find a loving partner. Even if she could wait for someone, her sick mother cannot. She wants her mother to witness her wedding. To continue her plan, Son Hae-young recruits a groom on a marriage website. A thug, also a regular at the convenience store, accepts the job. When Kim Ji-wook accidentally sees their chat, worried that Son Hae-young is being deceived, he intentionally smashes his phone on the ground, steps on it, and crushes it underfoot. As a result, Kim Ji-wook was punched by a thug and had to compensate with a new phone. Kim Ji-wook was worried about Son Hae-young. Seeing her pass by the door, he quickly stepped forward to stop her. Standing close to Son Hae-young, he asked if she felt her heart racing. Son Hae-young said she felt nothing. Kim Ji-wook declared that he would be Son Hae-young's groom on one condition. Son Hae-young must take his cat home. He usually stayed at the examination institute, and the convenience store manager was afraid of cats and couldn't care for them. As long as Son Hae-young agreed to keep the cat, he would be willing to be the groom. Son Hae-young didn't like cats, but to achieve her goal, she agreed to the condition. The first step was complete. Next, they went together to rent a wedding suit. On the subway, Son Hae-young asked Kim Ji-wook why he suddenly hugged her the day before. Kim Ji-wook was testing if Son Hae-young was allergic to cat hair, as his clothes had a lot of it. Son Hae-young was slightly disappointed. She thought Kim Ji-wook was testing their mutual feelings. Kim Ji-wook claimed that if any personal feelings developed between them, it would only be dislike or extreme disgust. Son Hae-young reminded him that affection grows naturally and told him not to speak too absolutely. At the store, Son Hae-young tried on a wedding dress and asked Kim Ji-wook for his opinion. Kim Ji-wook thought it was embarrassing. Son Hae-young wanted this effect. She wanted the guests to focus on her and ignore the groom. They were having a fake wedding, and Kim Ji-wook had a bright future ahead. She hoped no one would remember Kim Ji-wook got married. Kim Ji-wook was surprised. The usually uncompromising Son Hae-young was actually considering his feelings, which changed his impression of her. While Kim Ji-wook was trying on a suit, Son Hae-young ran into her ex-boyfriend and his wife. Kwon Yi-rin enthusiastically helped Son Hae-young choose a wedding dress and recommended a suit for the groom. Just as Son Hae-young felt awkward, Kim Ji-wook's voice came asking if he could come out. Thinking of Kim Ji-wook's poor appearance, Son Hae-young hastily explained that he had just come from work and was a bit disheveled. To her surprise, when Kim Ji-wook turned around, both she and Kwon Yi-rin covered their mouths. Kim Ji-wook suited up, drawing the gaze of every woman present. They all stared at his handsome face. Even Son Hae-young was captivated by his charm. Her ex-boyfriend felt provoked, noting that Kim Ji-wook was younger than Son Hae-young, mocking the idea of an older woman marrying a younger man. Kim Ji-wook affectionately called Son Hae-young older sister, pointing out that relationships with younger men were trendy. Kwon Yi-rin was unclear about their relationship, curious about how Son Hae-young and Kim Ji-wook knew each other. Just as Son Hae-young was about to make up an excuse, Kim Ji-wook answered first, saying they had known each other since childhood. After leaving a bridal shop, Son Hae-young scolded Kim Ji-wook, asking why he hadn't warned her about his good looks. A passerby suddenly started a conversation, noting the sloppy dress of another man, wondering how Son Hae-young could praise him. Unable to describe Kim Ji-wook in a suit, she watched him drink coffee, doubting that this shabby man was the same handsome one from before. Son Hae-young wanted to know why Kim Ji-wook had shown off his good looks at the bridal shop. He explained he wanted to overshadow her ex with his appearance. Kim Ji-wook also wondered how her ex had remarried so quickly after their breakup. Son Hae-young revealed the truth. She had been deceived for 6 months during their relationship. From Kim Ji-wook's words, Son Hae-young realized he knew a lot about her, her home, friends, and even her ex's situation. Kim Ji-wook complained about her loud talking in convenience stores, noting he wasn't deaf and could hear her clearly. On the way home, her ex kept thinking about Kim Ji-wook's statement that they had known each other since childhood, suspecting it was the reason Son Hae-young broke up with him, even suspecting she had cheated before he did. Kwon Yi-rin noticed his concern and asked if he was jealous, shocking him as he thought she had noticed something. However, she thought he was jealous of her looking at Kim Ji-wook. With the wedding coming up, Son Hae-young started distributing invitations and wedding candies to her colleagues, who noticed the invitation lacked the most crucial thing, the groom's photo. Son Hae-young claimed she was keeping it a surprise for the wedding day. When asked if the groom had proposed, Son Hae-young recalled asking Kim Ji-wook to have a fake marriage with her, which she somewhat considered a proposal, thus affirming that they got engaged before marrying. Her ex revealed she had no ring, suggesting a proposal should have one, boasting his own ring. Curious about how the groom proposed without a ring, Son Hae-young felt embarrassed, but promised to reveal the proposal video at the wedding. To accomplish her task, Son Hae-young picked out proposal items from a secondhand market and had Kim Ji-wook play along in staging the proposal. Kim Ji-wook refuses to use secondhand items and kneel in front of Son Hae-young to pretend, even after her repeated requests. He only needs to say one line without preparing anything else, yet he still pushes her away. Son Hae-young complains in front of the students, asking what will happen to their baby if they can't marry. The students sympathize with her and criticize Kim Ji-wook, calling him a jerk. Feeling wronged, Kim Ji-wook shows the students his cat, claiming it as his baby, exposing Son Hae-young's lie. Determined to create video content, Son Hae-young acts alone, pretending to be filmed by a boyfriend, mimicking being fed, acting spoiled during a walk, and shopping together at a supermarket. She is satisfied with her performance, but her friends comment that her laughter seems fake and forced. With no other options to complete her task, Son Hae-young buys a ring and rents a groom's ring. While trying on rings, she receives a message from Nam Ji-yeon to pick up a package at a convenience store. Upon entering the store, the door locks behind her, and the lights suddenly go out. Son Hae-young sees a row of small lights on the floor and follows them inside, discovering a proposal banner on the wall. A toy car with a gummy ring stops in front of her, and Kim Ji-wook appears, asking if she likes the elaborate proposal setup. Before she can respond, he unveils shelves filled with her favorite discontinued gummy candy. Son Hae-young is stunned, learning that Kim Ji-wook had purchased the entire stock from the candy company to please her within his means. Happy, Son Hae-young eats the candy and considers reimbursing the cost. Kim Ji-wook refuses, explaining he needs the wedding because someone wants him to move to Canada. He hopes that by showing he has a family, they will stop contacting him. The wedding proceeds as planned. To minimize Kim Ji-wook's exposure and keep him free, Son Hae-young greets the guests alone. Her ex-boyfriend, struck by her beauty in the wedding dress, almost reaches out to her, but Kwon Yi-rin stops him in time. During the ceremony, Son Hae-young arranges a special event for children cared for by their mothers, even those with memory loss. Missing her father, who didn't live to see her marry, she feels sad until Kim Ji-wook joins her, firmly walking her down the aisle. Seeing her mother, who is also confused, Son Hae-young struggles to hold back tears. After the wedding, Kim Ji-wook returns the ring, ending their act. Unexpectedly, her ex-boyfriend and Kwon Yi-rin pass by, prompting Son Hae-young to quickly put the ring back on, fearing her lies will be exposed. While she heads to a honeymoon hotel to keep up appearances, Kim Ji-wook's role ends there. Kwon Yirin and her companion also headed to the honeymoon hotel and warmly invited Son Hae-young and her husband to ride with them. Son Hae-young declined the offer, and Kwon Yirin left first, but said she would wait for them at the hotel. With no choice left, Son Hae-young begged Kim Ji-wook to continue the act. Kim Ji-wook agreed to drop her off at the hotel and leave. When they arrived at the hotel lobby, they ran into Kwon Yirin. All four took the elevator together. To show off, her ex-boyfriend hugged Kwon Yirin tightly. Not to be outdone, Son Hae-young grabbed Kim Ji-wook's arm and wrapped it around her waist. They reached their room door, and as Kim Ji-wook was about to leave after setting down their things, Kwon Yirin, who was staying next door, opened her door and invited them to breakfast the next morning. Son Hae-young had no choice but to have Kim Ji-wook stay the night. Kim Ji-wook lectured her on her lack of safety awareness, to which Son Hae-young responded that in her eyes, Kim Ji-wook was not a man, but an angel. Kim Ji-wook playfully threatened her as they entered the room, unsure if he could still maintain his angelic demeanor. Suddenly, her ex-boyfriend came out of his room, and they quickly hid in theirs, both unconsciously laughing. The atmosphere grew ambiguous as they looked at each other closely. Son Hae-young playfully teased Kim Ji-wook, who looked into her eyes. There was a secret he hadn't told Son Hae-young. During the wedding, when the groom was supposed to hug the bride's mother, she quietly called him by the nickname Xiao Shu. Kim Ji-wook openly admitted he was Xiao Shu. Son Hae-young learned this was Kim Ji-wook's first time in a hotel and playfully posed seductively, pretending to be experienced in guiding him. Kim Ji-wook suspected Son Hae-young still cherished their earlier kiss during the wedding, where he kissed her cheek instead of her lips to avoid exposure, despite the guest's dissatisfaction demanding a real kiss. The applause continued, and the kiss could not stop until Son Hae-young's mother suddenly became distressed, wanting to leave, and the kissing scene was skipped. Recalling this, Son Hae-young joked that she would only miss kissing someone of equal experience, sarcastically indicating that Kim Ji-wook was inexperienced. Kim Ji-wook suddenly pinned her down, saying that just because he hadn't been to a hotel didn't mean he hadn't done other things. They stared intently at each other, and as Kim Ji-wook leaned close to Son Hae-young's lips, he stopped to ask why she hadn't closed her eyes. Son Hae-young pulled him closer by the neck. She then accused Kim Ji-wook and pushed him away. Kim Ji-wook went to shower, and Son Hae-young took a deep breath, realizing she had almost been overwhelmed by desire but had managed to control herself. They settled the wedding gifts, and seeing Son Hae-young very tired, Kim Ji-wook told her to sleep first while he sorted things out alone. Son Hae-young, not trusting anyone else with the money, felt she couldn't trust Kim Ji-wook either, always suspecting he was hiding something. Whenever they talked about personal matters, Kim Ji-wook would change the subject or remain silent. Kim Ji-wook confessed that his mother lived in Canada, and he had been raised by his grandmother. His grandmother's dying wish was that his mother's new family not know about him, asking him to live alone and not disturb his mother. For his grandmother, her daughter was always the priority, and he was always secondary. After listening, Son Hae-young leaned forward and gently blew into Kim Ji-wook's eyes, which were filled with sadness. She was worried that Kim Ji-wook might start crying. The next day, Kim Ji-wook drove Son Hae-young to the airport for her honeymoon. He was surprised she was actually traveling, as he thought she would spend the holiday with her mother. Son Hae-young confessed that although she loved her mother, their relationship was not very strong. Her mother had many other concerns and always placed her last, believing it was the right thing to do because she was her biological daughter. After explaining, Son Hae-young handed Kim Ji-wook some money, not a lot, but enough to cover a round-trip flight to Canada, should he wish to travel. Kim Ji-wook bid farewell to Son Hae-young, wishing her a pleasant trip. Son Hae-young called him husband, indicating that to her grandmother, a daughter was more important than a granddaughter. But to her, her husband was most important. She showed her wedding ring, signaling they were still a family. Kim Ji-wook looked deeply at Son Hae-young, feeling very warm inside. On the plane, Son Hae-young found an envelope in her bag from Kim Ji-wook, containing some money and a letter he had written while she was asleep the previous night. He had thought about how perfect the wedding would have been if it was for true love. Regardless of the outcome, as long as Son Hae-young felt happy, he felt it was worth it. Son Hae-young closed the letter, aware that no one else knew that there was genuine affection hidden within the staged act. 3 months later, Son Hae-young won first place in a creative competition and was about to be promoted to team leader. The company organized a recognition ceremony, expected to be presented by President Park Kyu-hyun. However, he was unexpectedly unable to attend, simplifying the award process. An ex-boyfriend mocked Son Hae-young, suggesting it was the start of her bad luck. Colleagues celebrated her honor at a dinner where the ex-boyfriend, now with his charming wife, became the center of attention. The atmosphere around Son Hae-young was cold, and a colleague suggested she invite her husband. She lied that he had gone to Canada, although she did not know Kim Ji-wook's whereabouts since their airport farewell. 3 months earlier, on her first day back from the honeymoon, Son Hae-young went to the convenience store to find Kim Ji-wook, but found he had resigned and no one knew his whereabouts. Unable to reach him on his phone, she took the cat he had asked her to care for back home. The cat was mischievous, and Son Hae-young found herself dealing with its mess while missing its owner. Meanwhile, her friend, homebody writer Nam Ji-yeon, met her crush at Son Hae-young's wedding. Nam Ji-yeon had liked Yo Ha-jun, Park Kyu-hyun's secretary, since school. He recognized her too, and they chatted warmly. In school, Nam Ji-yeon liked writing novels, and Yo Ha-jun asked if she continued. Embarrassed by the romantic yet racy content of her novels, she claimed to write love fairy tales instead. Both were reluctant to part, so Yo Ha-jun gave Nam Ji-yeon his business card, which she placed in a spot easily visible to inspire her writing. However, she didn't expect a troll to suddenly post hundreds of offensive comments on her novel. Meanwhile, he confided to Yeo Ha-jun about a novel with explicit content that deeply disturbed him, especially since the male protagonist shared his name, prompting unwanted associations. Park Kyu-hyun explained that he accidentally saw the novel on his mother's tablet without closing the page. To protect her, he posted multiple malicious comments. Despite knowing about his father's infidelity since childhood, he grew up to be an upright person. His mental state deteriorated before the trolling could stop, shocked by the venomous words he himself had uttered. Nam Ji-yeon sued the troll. Unable to hide the matter, Park Kyu-hyun faced severe reprimand from his father, who instructed him to turn himself in anonymously to prevent jeopardizing his chance to become the company president. With Yeo Ha-jun's help, Park Kyu-hyun disguised himself as a jobless drifter and followed Yeo Ha-jun's advice to drop his ego and identity, confessing sincerely to the police. During this, Nam Ji-yeon observed Park Kyu-hyun secretly and remembered his face. When he left the police station, she shouted and rushed towards him, accidentally getting knocked down herself. Her phone flew out, and as Park Kyu-hyun helped pick it up, a message addressed her as the Light Purple author, revealing her identity. Shocked, Nam Ji-yeon fled without her phone. Son Hae-young, receiving a distress call from Nam Ji-yeon, hurried to find her and was surprised to encounter Park Kyu-hyun outside the police station. Mistaking his appearance for a thug, she felt regretful that he missed the award ceremony, where he later made an inspiring speech, encouraging Son Hae-young to keep striving. Son Hae-young found Nam Ji-yeon in a phone booth and retrieved her phone from the police, asking her what she wanted to do next, unaware that her attacker was the admired Park Kyu-hyun. Nam Ji-yeon chose not to pursue further, since Park Kyu-hyun had helped her up and returned her phone, proving his good nature. The next day, Yo Ha-jun took a day off to meet a friend near the company, causing Park Kyu-hyun, who was unhappy about Yeo Ha-jun making friends behind his back, to secretly follow him and discover that the friend was the Light Purple author. Simultaneously, as the company welcomed new employees, Son Hae-young greeted them and noticed a familiar face among the crowd. Son Hae-young was shocked to see Kim Ji-wook, not expecting him to be a new colleague. Kim Ji-wook had a compelling reason to work here. After Son Hae-young's wedding, a stranger approached Kim Ji-wook, threatening him with his mother's photo. He demanded Kim Ji-wook to comply or expose him as a secret child to his mother's family. Remembering his grandmother's last wish, Kim Ji-wook had no choice but to agree. The man's demand was for him to work at Ganlin Education, where Son Hae-young works. Kim Ji-wook had promised Son Hae-young's mother he would fulfill her request before joining the company. Son Hae-young suspected Kim Ji-wook had a hidden motive for his sudden appearance, but couldn't ask before Kwon Yeerin called her to train the new employees. Kwon Yeerin thought Kim Ji-wook looked a lot like Son Hae-young's husband and almost thought her husband had returned from Canada. Son Hae-young awkwardly laughed, saying her husband was handsome and the new employee couldn't compare. This dispelled Kwon Yeerin's suspicions. During training, Son Hae-young stared intently at Kim Ji-wook, who knew she was probably upset. After training, Son Hae-young chased after Kim Ji-wook, pulling him aside in the stairwell where he confessed. He didn't want to meet Son Hae-young this way, but was compelled by his difficult situation. Son Hae-young bombarded him with questions about his whereabouts. Kim Ji-wook admitted he avoided her calls on purpose, unable to disclose his location honestly and unwilling to lie. Now, Son Hae-young worried about Kim Ji-wook being recognized at the company, risking exposure of their sham marriage. Kim Ji-wook reassured her that those who saw him at the wedding wouldn't remember, and he would be cautious. Son Hae-young warned him that if his identity was revealed, the next ceremony would be his funeral. Meanwhile, Bak Yoo-hyun followed Yeo Ha-jun, who met with Nam Ja-yeon, the writer he had criticized online. Bak Yoo-hyun suspected Nam Ja-yeon of scheming to extort him. From across the street, he called Yeo Ha-jun, who claimed he was meeting a high school classmate. Upon learning Nam Ja-yeon was a children's book writer, Bak Yoo-hyun panicked, convinced she had ulterior motives. As Nam Ja-yeon received a call from Son Hae-young about the reappearing fake groom, she suspected someone might threaten Son Hae-young. Bak Yoo-hyun, thinking similarly of Nam Ja-yeon, sweated profusely. Fearing exposure, he quickly boarded a bus and fled when he heard car horns over the phone, suspecting Yeo Ha-jun was nearby. Nam Ja-yeon, having obtained Bak Yoo-hyun's written confession from the police, confronted him as he exited the police station. Unable to quell her anger over his malicious comments, she threw the confession papers on the ground, vowing never to forgive him. As Bak Yoo-hyun picked up the papers, a truck came barreling towards him. Nam Ja-yeon turned and fainted at the sight. Emergency swerving didn't hit anyone, but Nam Ja-yeon was found lying on the road. He hurriedly ran over and took Nam Ja-yeon to the hospital. Meanwhile, Son Hae-young took new and old employees to the park for activities aimed at attracting members. Kim Ji-wook wore a mascot costume to play with the children. Concerned about his fatigue, Son Hae-young handed him a bottle of water just in time. When Kim Ji-wook removed his headpiece, everyone was stunned by his good looks. Women stared at his sweaty face and the movement of his Adam's apple as he drank. Kim Ji-wook was surrounded by mothers eager to sign up as members. Son Hae-young, feeling bored, noticed a little boy sliding alone without a parent. Observing his posture, she deduced the child was injured. She approached and confirmed her suspicion by talking to him and taking a photo as evidence. The boy's father demanded her phone and assaulted her when she refused. Kim Ji-wook quickly intervened to protect Son Hae-young and fought with the man. Just as Kim Ji-wook was about to hit the man again, the boy shouted not to hurt his father. They ended up at the police station where the company's legal team arrived promptly. The lawyer secured surveillance footage and testimonies, confirming no liability. Son Hae-young was concerned about whether the police would help the boy out of his situation, but the lawyer informed her it was beyond the company's scope. Nevertheless, Son Hae-young argued that education should protect children, not just prepare them for tests, echoing Bak Yoo-hyun's words during his appointment. The lawyer asked Son Hae-young to email her the photos so she could look into the matter. The injured Son Hae-young and Kim Ji-wook treated each other's wounds. Kim Ji-wook was curious how Son Hae-young had spotted the boy's issues. She explained her experience with foster care and recognizing signs of abuse. Kim Ji-wook appreciated her mother's influence, acknowledging her as a good person. Son Hae-young, puzzled by Kim Ji-wook's fighting ability, suspected he had been forced to learn to defend himself. Kim Ji-wook revealed it was his grandmother who made him learn to protect himself, not wanting him to appear as an orphan. After a bus ride, Son Hae-young had to leave. Later, a mysterious man approached Kim Ji-wook, taking him to a luxury apartment and offering him a bank card and car keys, with the condition that he simply go to work on time and work hard. Kim Ji-wook suspected the man might be his father, but the man claimed to be sterile. Son Hae-young couldn't fathom Kim Ji-wook's reasons for joining the company. After she left, unaware, a box fell, scattering photos, including one of Kim Ji-wook and her mother. At work, despite Son Hae-young's attempts to avoid conflicts of interest, she and Kim Ji-wook ended up in the same team. The employees suggested a dinner gathering, which Son Hae-young led as a team-building activity. Midway, Son Hae-young stepped out for air, followed by Kim Ji-wook, whom she considered a ticking time bomb. Kim Ji-wook won't understand her feelings. Kim Ji-wook drives Son Hae-young home. At the doorstep, they unexpectedly find An Woo-jae drunk and sitting on the ground. Kim Ji-wook tries to contact Kwon Yiren to pick him up, but Son Hae-young disagrees. She doesn't want to escalate the situation and decides to hail a taxi for An Woo-jae. This makes Kim Ji-wook jealous. He suspects Son Hae-young still has feelings for her ex-boyfriend. They argue, and Kim Ji-wook leaves angrily. Son Hae-young tries to help An Woo-jae up, but fails. Kim Ji-wook carries An Woo-jae and puts him in the taxi. The next day, Son Hae-young is called by HR as soon as she arrives at work. HR received a complaint that Son Hae-young bullied a new employee, citing her harsh words to Kim Ji-wook the previous night. The bullying claim is upheld, and HR orders her demotion. Worried about her absence, Kim Ji-wook learns from a new colleague that he reported Son Hae-young for bullying him. Son Hae-young is held accountable by HR for mistreating Kim Ji-wook. She assumes Kim Ji-wook reported her and imagines him pushing her downstairs and locking her in a coffin. She questions his motives for being at the company, assuming it's to promote and then demote her. Ignoring barriers, Kim Ji-wook bursts in and declares to everyone that he is not the victim, but Son Hae-young's husband. To save her position, Son Hae-young quickly admits their relationship. HR believes Son Hae-young hid this to unfairly recruit Kim Ji-wook into her team. Kwon Yiren presents Son Hae-young's performance assessments of new employees, showing poor ratings for Kim Ji-wook. HR reviews this and concludes the workplace violence was just a marital dispute, not pursuing it further. The couple goes to the terrace to strategize, deciding to maintain their fake marriage. Son Hae-young encourages Kim Ji-wook to stay spirited. Kim Ji-wook, however, resents her for mistakenly thinking he reported her. To regain his trust, Son Hae-young tries a trust fall from a table, but Kim Ji-wook walks away. Turning around, she realizes he's gone and injures her ankle stepping down, but Kim Ji-wook catches her in time. To prevent suspicion, Son Hae-young coaches Kim Ji-wook on handling different people. First, they deal with An Woo-jae's questioning by confidently rebutting him. When team members express discomfort with Kim Ji-wook's presence, Son Hae-young exploits this to assign them more work, prompting them to leave. Finally, facing her supervisor and friend, Son Hae-young knows he's superficial. Before he speaks, she lets Kim Ji-wook charm him with compliments, diverting his inquiry. A mysterious person waited for him in the room. They investigated all his information, but missed that he was already married. They guessed the two weren't living together because they might have divorced. If Kim Ji-wook felt uncomfortable, he offered to get rid of Son Hae-young for him. Kim Ji-wook warned the mysterious person not to act impulsively, stating Son Hae-young is his wife. The mysterious person was pleased with his reaction, seeing more vulnerabilities to exploit. Kim Ji-wook left the room first. After he left, the mysterious person immediately called the chairman of Son Hae-young's company, Bak Yoo-hyun's father, reporting Kim Ji-wook's suspicions about the chairman. Son Hae-young went back to the jewelry store to rent the wedding ring she used, but found out that Kim Ji-wook had bought it before the rental period was up. Son Hae-young didn't understand why Kim Ji-wook bought the ring and thought he liked her. Her friends thought if Kim Ji-wook really liked her, he wouldn't have disappeared suddenly. Maybe he had a girlfriend and wanted to buy a couple rings, and he was just satisfied with the ring he had previously worn. Nam Ja-yeon woke up in the hospital and saw Bak Gyu-hyun lying on the floor. Remembering the truck hitting him, she thought she was seeing a ghost. Bak Gyu-hyun proved to her he was alive, paid her hospital bills, and bought her a new phone, hoping for reconciliation. Nam Ja-yeon learned from a nurse that Bak Gyu-hyun had carried her to the hospital and was touched. When they parted, Bak Gyu-hyun reminded her to pick up her blood test report next week, not to stay up late, and apologized again for the trouble caused. Nam Ja-yeon realized Bak Gyu-hyun was a good person and agreed to reconcile, but on one condition: Bak Gyu-hyun must volunteer at an orphanage for a day. Bak Gyu-hyun went to the orphanage and met Kim Ji-wook, who was also volunteering there. The two had never seen each other at the company and didn't know each other's identities. Seeing Kim Ji-wook and a girl assigned to tutor children while he was assigned to wash clothes, Bak Gyu-hyun, an educational sector veteran, also requested to tutor, but was declined. The director explained that the tutors were long-term volunteers. The girl had grown up in the orphanage, and Kim Ji-wook had been volunteering since high school. Bak Gyu-hyun accepted his fate and carried a large basin of washed clothes to dry. Unaccustomed to physical labor, he struggled and accidentally fell. Kim Ji-wook caught the clothes, and Bak Gyu-hyun, kneeling on the ground, criticized Kim Ji-wook for being unusual, as normal people would save him first. Kim Ji-wook retorted that keeping clean things from getting dirty was more important than saving him. Kim Ji-wook then helped Bok Gyu-hyun hang the clothes. The next day, Kim Ji-wook drove Son Hae-young to work and thoughtfully bought her breakfast. Son Hae-young ate lying down, and Kim Ji-wook, worried about her digestion, adjusted her seat. The atmosphere suddenly became warmer as their distance closed. Kim Ji-wook, struggling to control himself, removed a crumb from Son Hae-young's mouth and sat back. Son Hae-young, noticing the ring on Kim Ji-wook's hand, asked if he had a girlfriend. Kim Ji-wook denied it and was about to explain further when Son Hae-young suddenly received a call. The news of them helping a boy had spread, and reporters were coming to interview them. Bok Gyu-hyun heard reporters were coming for an interview and mistakenly thought his volunteer work at the welfare center had become known. He worried that if he gave the interview, Nam Ja-yeon would learn his identity and expose his malicious comments. To dismiss the reporters, Bok Gyu-hyun pushed open the meeting room door only to find Son Hae-young as the main subject of the interview. To his surprise, Kim Ji-wook, whom he had met at the welfare center, turned out to be a company employee. When Kim Ji-wook saw Bok Gyu-hyun signaling him, he pretended it was their first meeting and greeted him politely. While they were talking, Director Jang, under the chairman, came to announce the end of the press conference and invited Son Hae-young and Kim Ji-wook to dine with the chairman. Kim Ji-wook was shocked to find that Director Jang was the mysterious person who had threatened him. That day, the mysterious person arrived, and Kim Ji-wook had placed a recorder in the shoes at the doorway. When he returned, he clearly heard the recorded conversation, confirming the chairman was behind it all. Fearing harm to Son Hae-young, he wanted to stop her from taking the interview, but for Son Hae-young, representing the company, and dining with the chairman and his wife was an honor she wouldn't miss. After the interview, they dined with the chairman and his family, including An Woo-jae's husband. The chairman seemed very interested in Son Hae-young's family background, questioning her about her parents' status until interrupted by his wife. He then asked what Son Hae-young liked about Kim Ji-wook. To lighten the mood, Kwon Yi-rin joked that Son Hae-young had fallen for the handsome Kim Ji-wook at first sight. The chairman told Kim Ji-wook to thank his parents for making him so handsome. Kim Ji-wook, suspecting the chairman might be his biological father, sarcastically stated he did not know his father, but according to his grandmother, the man was a scoundrel who didn't recognize his own child. The atmosphere turned awkward, and to liven it up, the chairman's wife invited the young people to drink with her. Son Hae-young wakes up after drinking and finds herself sharing a bed with her fake husband. Before she can react, she sees An Woo-jae also on their bed. The three scream and jump out of the bed. Kim Ji-wook forgets he's pretending to be Son Hae-young's husband and moves towards An Woo-jae. Son Hae-young questions why they are in her room. An Woo-jae assumes they should be sharing a room as a married couple, but notices they are not only in separate rooms, but also seem unfamiliar with each other. Kim Ji-wook quickly moves closer to Son Hae-young. The door is knocked. Kwon Yi-rin is outside, causing panic among them. They fear they can't explain the chaos. Son Hae-young instructs them to pretend they blacked out and forgot last night. Kwon Yi-rin enters, unsurprised by the trio together. She reveals that last night, Bok Gyu-hyun and Yo Ha-jun helped the drunk trio into the room. Originally, Kwon Yi-rin booked the room across for An Woo-jae, who drunkenly stumbled into Son Hae-young's room. On learning this from a waiter, she meant to move An Woo-jae but couldn't due to their unconscious state. Relieved, An Woo-jae doesn't need to explain further. As he prepares to leave with Kwon Yi-rin, he realizes his watch is missing. Son Hae-young, knowing him well, suggests checking his shoe. He finds the watch and then his missing phone under the mattress. Kwon Yi-rin, seeing this, suspects their relationship. Before marrying An Woo-jae, she thought he and Son Hae-young were just colleagues who joined the company together. Now, their familiarity suggests more. Kim Ji-wook claims their work collaboration accounts for their closeness. Son Hae-young and An Woo-jae high-five, maintaining they are just friends. Kwon Yi-rin leaves unconcerned, but announces Son Hae-young as team leader of Group 1 and An Woo-jae as leader of Group 2. Kim Ji-wook is moved from Son Hae-young's group to An Woo-jae's, under his supervision. Bok Gyu-hyun originally planned to transfer Kim Ji-wook to another department to avoid any conflict of interest with Son Hae-young. Kwon Yi-rin, aiming to promote An Woo-jae, proposed he lead the new group and keep Kim Ji-wook in the department. She thought her strategy helped all three, unaware of their distress. Son Hae-young worries about working together as An Woo-jae might notice her and Kim Ji-wook's relationship, regretting their fake marriage. Kim Ji-wook says he's ready to cooperate if Son Hae-young wants a divorce. Son Hae-young feels it's not the right time to break ties. Seeing Kim Ji-wook distressed, she takes him for hangover soup. As they leave, An Woo-jae, who overheard their divorce talk, grows more suspicious. Kim Ji-wook returns home to find director Jang waiting. He always wanted to know his father, why he abandoned him and his mother, and never sought them out. Now he understands his father has another family and doesn't love him. Director Jang advises him that the past doesn't matter as much as why his father is reaching out now and what he can do for him in the future. Kim Ji-wook rejects this notion, telling Director Jang to inform the chairman he no longer accepts his goodwill and will move out of the house. Kim Ji-wook commutes with Son Hae-young. Son Hae-young fears An Woo-jae might discover their relationship. An Woo-jae knows how she acts when she's in love. To manage the crisis, she feels they should act like a couple all day, not just during commutes. To help Kim Ji-wook get into the role, she suggests even her eye crusts and yawns are beautiful. Kim Ji-wook expresses his fondness for Son Hae-young, who is very moved. Kim Ji-wook asks if he's acting convincingly. Upon reaching the company, they ride the elevator with many colleagues. Kim Ji-wook protects Son Hae-young, continuing to act like a loving couple. Son Hae-young is moved again and takes Kim Ji-wook's arm as they walk into the office closely. At lunch, Son Hae-young shares specially prepared sushi, lying that Kim Ji-wook made it. Kim Ji-wook is pinched and grudgingly admits he made it. Everyone happily tries it, although all show awkward expressions. Son Hae-young, having tasted one, realizes her good intentions backfired but reluctantly praises the taste. Colleagues gossip about the HR department investigating all employees for misconduct, with severe consequences for any infractions. Son Hae-young panics and forces Kim Ji-wook to move into her home to avoid suspicion. The attic atop her house, lacking a bathroom and kitchen, is his new home. Kim Ji-wook complains, having never entered but knowing such rooms typically lack facilities. As Son Hae-young retrieves cleaning tools, Kim Ji-wook comments on how long it's been since his last visit. Entering the room, Kim Ji-wook finds their wedding photo and more pictures with Son Hae-young's mother, reminiscing about moving in 9 years ago when he could call her mom or aunt. Elsewhere, Bok Yoo-hyun volunteers at an orphanage for the second time, having donated washing machines to avoid washing clothes himself, and brings Yeo Ha-joon to help. Nam Ja-yeon, hearing of the donation, suspects laziness and makes a surprise visit. Seeing Nam Ja-yeon, Bok Yoo-hyun panics. In front of Yeo Ha-joon, Nam Ja-yeon lies about being a children's book writer to hide her identity as an erotic novelist known as Light Purple. Yeo Ha-joon is aware of the connection between Bok Yoo-hyun and the Light Purple author, threatening to expose Nam Ja-yeon. To protect Nam Ja-yeon's identity, Bok Yoo-hyun grabs her hand and they run away before Yeo Ha-joon can see them together. After running, they stop, and Bok Yoo-hyun is moved by Nam Ja-yeon's bright smile. Nervous, he accidentally mentions Yeo Ha-joon's name, raising Nam Ja-yeon's suspicions. Nam Ja-yeon shyly admits she named her book's protagonist after someone she likes, named Yeo Ha-joon. Hurt, Bok Yoo-hyun makes an excuse for Nam Ja-yeon to leave first and goes to find Yeo Ha-joon. Nam Ja-yeon had noticed Bok Yoo-hyun's allergic reaction on his fingers from washing clothes, buys medicine for him, but sees him about to leave with Yeo Ha-joon. Not wanting to be seen by Yeo Ha-joon, Nam Ja-yeon quickly ducks and hides her face. Bok Yoo-hyun also saw Nam Ja-yeon push Yeo Ha-joon into a car and leave. After leaving the orphanage, Nam Ja-yeon received a new assignment. To prove she lives with Kim Ji-wook, Son Hae-young held a housewarming party, inviting colleagues over for a meal. Nam Ja-yeon and another close friend arrived early to help set up the house, creating traces of their living together. An Woo-jae raised an issue that the house lacked wedding items and looked unchanged. Kwon Yoo-rin became suspicious, wondering how he knew what Son Hae-young's house looked like before. Nam Ja-yeon lied that their new house was not there and that Kim Ji-wook had just moved in. Everyone chatted and laughed, with Kim Ji-wook's colleagues praising him as a very nice person, especially popular among the ladies. Female colleagues from the same training session complained about his early marriage after they found out. After everyone left, Son Hae-young apologized to Kim Ji-wook for delaying his chance to enjoy a romantic atmosphere and real love. Kim Ji-wook said those things could still be done now. He walked towards Son Hae-young passionately, As Son Hae-young saw his face getting closer, she closed her eyes. Kim Ji-wook picked up the keys behind her, telling her his body had followed his heart. Son Hae-young realized she had been moved by Kim Ji-wook many times. Life happens only once, and she didn't want to miss the chance. Understanding this, she chased him upstairs and kissed him. However, when Kim Ji-wook passionately kissed her back, she pulled away, claiming she was acting for An Woo-jae to see. After the party, Nam Ja-yeon drove Yeo Ha-joon away. On the way home, she saw An Woo-jae return and secretly check on Son Hae-young and Kim Ji-wook. Afraid that their fake marriage would be exposed, she quickly called Son Hae-young. To act, Son Hae-young rushed to the rooftop and kissed Kim Ji-wook. After witnessing An Woo-jae leave, she looked up. Kim Ji-wook accused her of being able to fake even a kiss. Son Hae-young argued it was just a peck. Kim Ji-wook didn't give her a chance to explain and kissed her. After the kiss, Son Hae-young didn't want to hide her feelings anymore and wanted to confess her feelings for Kim Ji-wook. But Kim Ji-wook, upset, didn't give her a chance to speak, claiming he also had to act. Two people who liked each other faced misunderstandings, but that kiss confused their emotions. Both spent the night sleepless, separately upstairs and downstairs. In the morning, Kim Ji-wook had a stomach ache and urgently needed to use the bathroom. There was no restroom on the rooftop, and he was embarrassed to share one with two women, so he hurried out to find a public restroom. Before he could leave the yard, Nam Ja-yeon called him for breakfast. Kim Ji-wook hurriedly declined, then bumped into Cha Hui-sung, who bragged about the delicacies he had just bought and invited Kim Ji-wook to join him. Kim Ji-wook, sweating from urgency, ran to use the restroom on the first floor. Nam Ja-yeon called him again for breakfast, but Kim Ji-wook was still upset with Son Hae-young. They sat down and continued to bicker. Nam Ja-yeon exposed their kiss on the rooftop from last night. Kim Ji-wook complained that Son Hae-young had initiated it. Son Hae-young blamed Kim Ji-wook for kissing her while holding her hands behind her back. Yet, both refused to admit they were together, arguing about the kiss from the previous night. After breakfast, Nam Ja-yeon met with Bok Gyu-hyun. She had learned he was the president of Son Hae-young's company and was willing to reconcile officially, no longer requiring Bok Gyu-hyun to volunteer at the orphanage, hoping they would never meet again. Bok Gyu-hyun, reluctant to part ways with Nam Ja-yeon, invited her to dinner. As Nam Ja-yeon was about to refuse, she turned and saw her despicable father, who had long tormented her and her mother. Overwhelmed by painful memories, she panicked and quickly grabbed Bok Gyu-hyun's hand to flee. They stopped in an alley where Nam Ja-yeon, unable to calm her emotions, began to cry silently. Bok Gyu-hyun, without asking why, took off his coat and draped it over her. He then sat beside her and comforted her with a song. Touched by the memories of their time together since they met, despite knowing each other through hurtful comments, Nam Ja-yeon felt an affection for Bok Gyu-hyun. Despite Bok Gyu-hyun's wish to not make this their last meeting, Nam Ja-yeon felt they were from different worlds and didn't want Yeo Ha-joon to know she was the Lavender Writer. She decided it was best they not meet again. Unable to control his feelings, Bok Gyu-hyun wrote many praises in the comment section of Nam Ja-yeon's new novel, unable to stop reading her captivating stories. Nam Ja-yeon was pleased with Bok Gyu-hyun's actions and reached out to Yeo Ha-joon, who complained about being mistreated by Bok Gyu-hyun. Bok Gyu-hyun had also ordered him to write malicious comments in the Lavender Writers section, starting from chapter 51, which Nam Ja-yeon had reported to the police for defamation. Shocked, she never expected those harsh words had come from Yeo Ha-joon. Meanwhile, Kim Ji-wook, attempting to make amends with Son Hae-young, deliberately tightened a jam jar so tight he couldn't open it himself, removed the batteries from the TV remote, and even sabotaged a light bulb, hoping Son Hae-young would seek his help. However, Son Hae-young easily solved each issue on her own, leaving Kim Ji-wook feeling defeated. He sought advice from a married colleague on how to appease someone after an argument. The colleague advised him to ensure he never repeats the offending action. Panicked, since he couldn't promise to never kiss Son Hae-young again, he wrote a letter of apology promising just that. Confident in his gesture, he was shocked when Son Hae-young crumpled the letter in anger and demanded he take her somewhere she could find peace. They ended up at the rooftop where Kim Ji-wook would often sleep. To make him more comfortable, Son Hae-young took him mattress shopping, choosing an expensive one, despite his preference for a cheaper option. She wanted him to have a comfortable quilt so he could heal from any daytime setbacks by resting comfortably at home. Touched by her kindness, Kim Ji-wook confessed his deep feelings for Son Hae-young, admitting his heart had already fallen for her. Son Hae-young spoke her heart out, asking Kim Ji-wook to wait for her until she no longer had to worry about her career, evaluations, promotions, or their fake marriage being discovered. She wanted to be with him when she could focus solely on him. This was what she had intended to say the day she kissed him, but An Woo-jae had ruined the moment. Son Hae-young and An Woo-jae visited an orphanage to discuss a partnership. The director asked if they knew Kim Ji-wook, who had just joined their company, and was pleased to hear he might visit often since he was in their team. Turning to a girl named Yoo-na, she remarked that Yoo-na was lucky, causing Yoo-na to shyly run out. An Woo-jae, sensing something, pressed the director on how he knew Kim Ji-wook. The director revealed that Kim Ji-wook had been a volunteer teacher at the orphanage for 7 to 8 years, and Yoo-na, who liked Kim Ji-wook a lot, was his assistant. Confused, An Woo-jae blurted out that Kim Ji-wook was married, but Son Hae-young quickly kicked him. The director thought An was referring to Kim Ji-wook and Yoo-na, commenting that they were young and there was no rush to marry, supporting their dating first. After leaving the orphanage, An Woo-jae confronted Son Hae-young about her fake marriage and threatened to ask the director for the truth. Unable to deny it any longer, Son Hae-young responded with silence. An Woo-jae assumed she had married on a whim after being hurt by him and begged her for time to possibly reconcile, regardless of his status with Kwon Yi-rin. Son Hae-young, furious, grabbed an umbrella from the trunk and beat him. Now that An Woo-jae knew about the fake marriage, Son Hae-young wanted to inform Kim Ji-wook immediately. Kim Ji-wook also had something to tell her. While she was away, he had gone out to take out the trash and encountered Director Jang, who confessed he had been fired by the chairman's wife. He came to warn Kim Ji-wook that the chairman's wife knew about him and advised him to think about how to protect his wife, suggesting he needed to become a tiger to survive the den of tigers. Both having urgent news, Kim Ji-wook suggested they tidy up the room first. Son Hae-young helped with the curtains but struggled to reach. Kim Ji-wook stepped behind her to help. When she turned around, they faced each other, their eyes met, and the atmosphere turned intimate. Just as they were about to kiss, Bak Yoo-hyun burst in and revealed Kim Ji-wook's true identity.